evening and welcome to this evening public worship at St John's Presbyterian Church, Annerley. As indicated this morning, we have sought to make all our church family aware of the change in circumstances in response to the decision taken by the Presbyterian Church of Queensland to suspend all in-house personal attendance public worship for the foreseeable future to protect our church family's personal health and safety. This morning, we endeavour to undertake a live stream of our public worship. However, it is acknowledged that, being our first attempt, it was not entirely successful. We trust that this evening's transmission will be much improved, and thank you for your presence via this medium and covenant your patience as we perfect these transmissions. With all our regular groups recessed for the time being, it is our intention over these coming weeks to maintain and develop links within our church family and to keep all informed of new developments. We would encourage church family members to keep in touch with one another as we go through these changing circumstances. Our worship this evening is led by our resident pastor, Martin Duffield. As is our habit, we continue to commend to you those of our church family under some affliction. Various church family members are dealing with ongoing illness, discomfort and recovery, and these have been mentioned over these past months. We would commend each one to your prayerful concern, despite our absence from one another. So please refer to the bulletin for further details on individuals and or their families. As previously mentioned, it is our intention to live stream our public worship services, and therefore in respect of this, God willing, next Sunday, Reverend Martin Duffield will lead morning worship and Reverend Richard Wilson in the evening. Again, we bring to your attention the Easter weekend. The Easter Remembrance is only some 2 weeks away now. It is the session's intention to letterbox drop suburban homes of Annerley over these coming weeks. And if you're able to assist, please contact their pastor or one of the elders. Just finally, please be aware that some information in the bulletin today with regards to worship service attendance, etc., has been superseded since its publication. All congregational group meetings will not apply until further advised. We are now encouraged to engage in personal preparation just prior to the call for worship. Thank you.
Thank you. our blood and bread as we adore him in our prayer this evening. Let's all pray. Almighty God, Lord of the heavenly hosts, it is good to come into your holy temple tonight, to seek your face, to call upon your glorious name in a time of trouble. For whom do we have in heaven or on earth beside you? And to whom else can we look when our enemies, which are vast often far greater and more powerful than us, trouble us? We praise you for that most blessed attributes which you possess, and by which we are protected from such foes as we have, and because of which we know no one can escape the consequences of their action, including those actions which harm your holy people and hinder your work on earth. And it is that blessed attribute of justice. O God, our Father, we praise your name this evening, because our Lord Jesus, your eternal Son, is our King. He ever lives to intercede for us as our great High Priest. We are greatly reassured in the knowledge that he is our King, who subdues and who conquers our enemies and his. Blessed is his name above all names, for he can sweep away any enemy, whether a powerful individual or a powerful institution, or a powerful nation. Nothing and no one is a match for his power and wisdom as the Son of God Most High, who rules the nations with a rod of iron, and whom we also tonight in the spirit of worship. So hear us and accept our praises this evening. Even though as your holy people we are scattered to our own homes because of this pandemic, help us to worship you from these humble places of residence, knowing that the temple of God is not a building, but it is the gathering of your people in spirit and in truth. And so thank you for giving us this hour, and this privilege, and this willingness. Bless the transmission of our worship to the glory of your majesty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. For we pray in the name of Jesus Christ the righteous. Amen. Let's hear from the Word of God, from the book of the prophet Ezekiel, chapter 34.
Ezekiel, chapter 34, verses 1 to 10, verse 1. And the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, prophesy against the shepherds of Israel. Prophesy and say to them, Thus says the Lord God to the shepherds, Woe to the shepherds of Israel who feed themselves. Should not the shepherds feed the flocks? You eat the fat and clothe yourselves with the wool. You slaughter the fatlings, but you do not feed the flock. The weak you have not strengthened, nor have you healed those who are sick, nor bound up the broken, nor brought back what was driven away, nor sought what was lost. But with force and cruelty you have ruled them. So they were scattered because there was no shepherd, and they became food for all the beasts of the field when they were scattered. My sheep wandered through all the mountains and on every hill. Yes, my flock was scattered over the whole face of the earth, and no one was seeking or searching for them. Therefore, you shepherds, hear the word of the Lord. As I live, says the Lord God, surely because my flock became a prey, and my flock became food for every beast in the field, because there was no shepherd, nor did my shepherds search for my flock, but the shepherds fed themselves and did not feed my flock. Therefore, O shepherds, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God, Behold, I am against the shepherds, and I will require my flock at their hand. I will cause them to cease feeding the sheep, and the shepherds shall feed themselves no more. For I will deliver my flock from their mouths, that they may no longer be food for them. And to God be all the glory. Amen.
Amen. Let's sing of that great shepherd from the traditional Christmas carol 165, O Come, O Come. Respond to their provocations and badly. We know, our Father, that we cannot control the way people act, but we can control the way we react. And so, our God, save us from ourselves. Lord, teach us to live and to love with all the patience and grace that is necessary not only to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bonds of peace, but to positively edify all others, to encourage them, and to thereby build up the body. Help us especially to be patient with those who wrong us and others, and help us to be wise in dealing with them, that at all times we may bring peace where possible with all men as we are called. Our Father, let love be the ruling grace within us, with all the many facets it has for dealing with all the many facets of evil. Fill us with your Holy Spirit, who is the Spirit of Jesus Christ, so that our sincere desire to respond in love will be matched with the power to love as only the Spirit can supply. Let him bring Christ out of us, who has put Christ in us by the washing and the renewal, by the regeneration of the Holy Spirit. This, Lord, is one of our many sins, but one of our many sins, and many one of our many ways of sinning. Forgive us for them all, we pray, and help us to keep on truly repenting of them all, that we would more and more be like the blessed Jesus, and less like the great enemy who so seeks our sin. We pray in our Lord Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to hear now again from the Gospel of John, this time, chapter 10, verses 7 to 21.
John chapter 10, verse 7. Then Jesus said to them again, "Most assuredly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved, and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. I have come that they may have life, and that they may have it more abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. But a hireling, he who is not the shepherd, one who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. And the wolf catches the sheep and scatters them. The hireling flees because he is a hireling and does not care about the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and am known by my own. As the Father knows me, even so I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And other sheep I have which are not of this fold, them also I must bring. They will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. Therefore my Father loves me, because I lay down my life, that I may take it again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This command I have received from my Father." Therefore there was a division again among the Jews because of these sayings. And many of them said, "He has a demon and is mad. Why do you listen to him?" Others said, "These are not the words of one who has a demon. Can a demon open the eyes of the blind?" And again, to God be all the glory. Amen.
Amen. Well, let us take a...
Thank you.
though we are apart from one another for the first time today, though we cannot give as one man. Today, for your glory and cause, we thank you for the generosity and the sense of gratitude that moves us to give. We thank you for the precious and unified body of this work, which they scatter far afield across the city and suburbs in these hours of worship for the time being. We now remain closely knit in the love of Christ today and every day in your blessed service. So take our gifts and their gifts, those that are delivered during the coming week, and use them to the praise of your glory and for the blessing of the gospel of the kingdom in our Lord Jesus' name. Amen. We are dealing tonight with the subject of conflict against foes within the church, and so we're going to sing a hymn appropriately, 460, stand up for Jesus. In spite of the surreal situation we find ourselves in as a church and as a world, Because of the lateness of the change, I have determined to preach the sermon I had already planned by Friday night. I do hope to address our remarkable situation in the morning services in the Sundays to come, starting with some meditations on Psalm 21. We must bring God's word to bear upon the situation, because there's much to be considered. I also chose to stay with our subject tonight from Titus to keep our life as normal as possible in such extraordinary times. So let's turn to the matter before us tonight. Now, I've heard pastors say that if they had known what the congregation was like, they never would have taken a call to it. And the younger you are, the more likely you are to confess that with the passage of time. I want to assure you that I haven't said that to anyone about this place. But it pleases God sometimes to send pastoral families or to ordain and induct elders in congregations in which some seriously difficult people reside. More than that, they can occupy positions of power and influence and can be more than a thorn in the side of other leaders in the congregation. So Titus was left to appoint elders. Yes, a happy task of finding good and gifted and godly men to shepherd the flock. But here now is the other part of that call, which involves dealing with those who would harm the flock. I introduced this last Sunday evening, and tonight we go into the details under this heading, A Ministry Among Beasts. Do you think the title is a little bit melodramatic? Well, that term is the Holy Spirit's term in verse 12. So tonight I'm going to look at something of the character of these beasts, their behaviour and their victims, and of course their match in the courageous elder. But we'll look firstly at the background to this ministry to beasts. This ministry among the wild beasts of Crete was necessary because the gospel arrived on that island community as a probable result of the preaching on the day of Pentecost. Acts 2:11 numbers the Cretans among those who had heard and responded to the gospel. They took their newfound faith back to Crete, and by the time of Paul's visit or visits, they were happily there was happily flourishing, it seems, and even though some of its number were not thoroughly converted, if not converted at all. So as a result of that fact, that the very fact of members not being truly humble or submissive to God, Titus was confronted with trying to rein in their destructive behaviour and example. It was no small task, and not one for the faint-hearted or lacking courage. What made it worse was that Titus was not dealing with bad character traits that came from isolated individuals or that might run through a family. After all, you can get those, and they can bring great grief and conflict to a body of believers. A uniting church minister once said to me that 95% of the problems that the church faces are people's personal and family issues that are simply brought into the church, into its institutions and relationships. However, this was far more difficult and deeper than mere personality or family problems. This was a problem in the whole culture, a common set of behavioural traits that would not only have been difficult to change, even with God's grace, but also hard to keep change, more of that in a moment. Let's turn to some of the things listed that were part of the culture of Crete that brought such destructive behaviour to the congregations of that island state. And the first was, incredibly, the culture of lying. So what are these traits in the corrupt moral and social culture of the Cretans? We have a sad and troubling list from Paul, who tries to sharpen Titus's mind by being very blunt. He wanted Titus fully informed and very clear about what he was confronting in verses 10 and 12. I quote, "For there are many insubordinate, both idle talkers and deceivers, especially among those of the circumcision, whose mouths must be stopped and who subvert old households, teaching things which they ought not for the sake of dishonest gain. And one of them, a prophet of their own, said, Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, and lazy gluttons." So the words that I want to consider tonight are the words in the quote from the poet. Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, and lazy gluttons. So what exactly is that doing in a poem? And why does Paul call the author a prophet? Well, the saying is actually quite an infamous one. Historians tell us that it was first coined by a man named Epimenides in the 6th century BC, around the time of the return of Israel from exile. Although he was held up as a prophet, even as a divine man by some like Plato, it is more likely he was called a prophet because he predicted the nature of the Cretans long before Paul's time and with great accuracy. That is, they are liars, and they always would be liars. 600 years after Epimenides made the comment, they were. Some believe that they were actually influenced by the early Phoenician colonists in what is called this despicable vice of lying. Apparently the Phoenicians were too. In fact, their fame as liars was such that the name Cretan became a byword for lying, as Joseph Benson explained. As for their proneness to falsehood, it is well known that to talk like a Cretan was a proverb for lying. So what we have here is a national trait of the culture, so deeply ingrained in it that everyone seemed to be guilty of it. Now, all cultures have their sins. And if we were to ask what our countrymen's vices were, we would probably first think of drunkenness or maybe coarse language, even though these are common in all Western culture. However, I've never heard anyone say that all Australians or Americans or Britons are drunkards. But the Cretans have their problem in spades. Lying, of course, is one of the most infamous and dangerous of all vices. It was the vice that led to the fall of humanity. Satan was not called the father of all lies, therefore, for nothing, in John 8:44. Lying is particularly treacherous because it abuses people's trust. It is a manipulative deception that sets up the victim for further evils, especially evils like theft and disadvantage. In this case, it was endemic in the culture. What was worse, it was therefore in the church. If unconverted Cretans were in the church, then we know for certain the lying was also in the church. Paul speaks elsewhere in this passage we've read of deceivers within this group, and that is a cunning form of lying with intent. It is men hiding things or distorting things, just as they did in their evil culture. We have seen this practice, actually, deception through lying, in churches and denominations in recent generations, with men who don't really uphold their vows, or men who don't think that vows matter. Dr. Nigel Lee was asked, I think, by myself, if an elder or a minister had a problem with any part of the confession at all, even a word or a sentence or two, could he still take the vows? The answer was swift and blunt, no. Either you own it all, or you don't vow it at all. The same is true of the community vows, dear brothers. You may not be bound to our church's doctrine like our ministers and elders, but you make 5 promises concerning your commitment to God and the life of the church, and while under you, if you don't mean those promises at the time, if you make promises because you want membership and privilege, and that too is lying. Remember Ecclesiastes 5, 4 and 5. When you make a vow to God, do not delay to pay it. for he has no pleasure in fools. Pay what you have vowed. Better not to vow than to vow and to not pay. By way of reverse application, I hardly need to say that as Christians, we need to be the most honest, the most ethical, the most self-effacing, the most transparent and open people on the earth. After all, God is watching and listening. And remember, the last communicant vow finishes as you will answer to God on the last day. So what we say, what people see, should be what they get. Think of the beautiful testimony of our Lord to Nathanael in John 1:47. Here is an Israelite in whom there is no guile. I once confronted a man from another culture about lying to me. And he responded by saying this was just their way of speaking. Well, it isn't the biblical way of speaking. It may have been in their culture as well. Well, it was in their culture as well to lie to each other. This man was an elder. And the other two elders were liars as well. So let me remind you before I leave this issue of the ministry of beasts, that the godly man is exactly the opposite to these kinds of so-called elders and ministers and members. It's beautifully captured in the words of Psalm 15:4. The godly man honors those who fear the Lord. He swears to his own injury, and he does not change. Whatever we are before the gospel comes, this is what we are afterwards. We tell the truth through our own injury. We will not back away from it, no matter what it costs us. With God's help, Titus would turn these beasts, these lying beasts, into saints, or else he would remove them for the sake of the well-being of the sheep. Well, that's the first part of the degradation of the culture that was corrupting the churches of Crete. The second one was the culture of aggressive selfishness. The degradation of the national character of Crete deepened with this awful description of them as evil beasts, our title phrase. One commentator defined it by saying that these words referred to their wild, fierce nature, their ferocity, and their love of cruelty. Albert Barnes defines the term like this. This would imply that there was a great lack of civilization, and that their want of refinement, or lack of refinement, was accompanied with what commonly exists in that condition, an unrestrained indulgence of wild and ferocious passions. Uncivilized people are by nature brutal. In fact, we could also use the word barbarian, which speaks of no sensitivity at all when injuring others. The words sociopath and psychopath come to mind. In the case of psychopath, this is where injuring others is actually pleasurable, especially if the person feels they are justified in some kind of perverse moral crusade to take their revenge upon others who wounded them. We might well also describe them as sociopaths, who are people who have no feeling for the pain and the suffering that they inflict upon others, though they don't get pleasure. In the church, the abuse of authority by powerful individuals and sometimes by erring courts brings all this home. To see people wounded in such situations is antithetical to the life and the teaching of Jesus Christ. And when it can't be restrained with reason or grace, then strong measures are needed against such people in courts, lest more vulnerable people be injured, as we've heard. How contrary to the nature of God's holy people. His people must have a culture of gentleness, of selflessness, of patience, of understanding, and of love. In contrast to the wild, uncivilized beast, God's people are to be the model of civility. In a bygone era, when our culture was distinctively ruled by a Christian ethos, we which penetrated deep into the fabric of society and the social relationship. Men used to be called gentlemen. Women used to be called ladies. Scripture sometimes uses the word to define such women, to use the word refined to describe such women who have social etiquette. That refers to proper training and discipline and grace and unselfish, sensitive and generous treatment of others. Well, we know that modern Cretans have sometimes been termed into English gentlemen. I think the Welsh miners were by Whitfield. Titus's job was to do the same, even if rebuking them was necessary. We know the word of the Spirit can transform a wild, ill-tempered, insensitive man into a gracious, patient, gentle, and generous soul, even if it takes time, and it often does. We know this because it has turned cannibals into preachers, such as its power. Well, the ministry of the beast confronts us with another, third severe character flaw in the culture, as if it couldn't get worse, which was apparently typical of most Cretans, and that is the lazy glutton. The culture of laziness and gluttony. So to lying and aggression, we now have a combination of gluttony and laziness. The Greek words here literally mean a slow belly. So one commentator said, these words are used especially of those who, by indulging their bodily appetites, become overweight and avoid activity. The spirit of self-indulgence that can stop them leads to overindulging, can also drive them to be inactive, especially with respect to serving others. It has other symptoms as well, but it is to be consumed in the end with self-indulgence. Some people are raised this way, and some, when they get enough money, often at a very young age, can choose to live this way. It is an easy and comfortable life when you never have to say no to yourself. Of course, the poster children of this problem are those we've seen on the news who eat and who sit in front of screens and become so big that physically they cannot leave the home. Such people can die very young. But this is a widespread problem in our Western culture today. We know it is the obesity problem. There are both dietary and lifestyle issues involved, but ultimately it comes down to personal discipline. Except where age or medication prevents activity or exercise, this is a sin at work in both greed and self-indulgence. And such people are pure consumers, spend their lives taking rather than giving. They endanger themselves unnecessarily in the face of illness and disease, and such were the Cretans of Titus' day. And when faith comes, when new life starts to breathe within a man or woman, they move away from selfish consumption to selfless production. They move away from indulgence to service and ministry. They begin to honour God, glorify God with their body and their mouths and their appetites. In fact, all they do is to the glory of God, as 1 Corinthians 10:31 says, instead of doing all to the pleasure itself, as is the cultural norm in so many instances today. When change comes, the Cretan moves from greed to sacrifice, and it is a beautiful, powerful example of the transforming of grace, the grace of God, when appetites are curbed, and when hands and feet are moved by a tender heart instead of being shackled by a selfish one. Someone has well said, busyness isn't always holiness, but holiness is always busyness. Titus's job was to transform those kinds of attitudes as well, to bring them back to an attitude and even to a look of disciplined men and women but they should be for God's glory. Paul would make the need to be active or busy and work clear in a threatening term of 2 Thessalonians 3:10. For even when we were with you, we commanded you this, that if anyone will not work, neither shall we eat. Working, industry, activity is the calling of all God's people. It is a covenantal responsibility bound up in the Dominion Charter to be fruitful and subdue the earth. It is after the pattern of our Lord Jesus Christ. He himself specifically condemned laziness as wickedness in Matthew 25:26. The Cretans belonged to a culture which was not industrious or as industrious as it should be. This then is the unholy trilogy of the beasts of Crete, who inhabited the congregations of Crete, and they are a warning to us, and left there, I believe, in part to that very end. This was the task of personal and cultural reform that confronted Titus at that time. I will look at the other comments in the other verses next time I lead the evening service and how we deal with it. Before I quit, I want to bring you some application to this. I want to draw several things to your attention tonight, which I believe are behind Paul's graphic description of the sort of people he calls wild beasts. And there are three things, very briefly. The first lesson is that some very disruptive people sometimes inhabit a church. Secondly, the leaders and members can sometimes face very distressing situations. And thirdly, that the influence of the world often lies behind these harsh realities. So very briefly, there are some very destructive people that sometimes inhabit our churches. It may shock us to discover that some people are not what they first appear. It may shock us to have to come to the terms, in fact, that some people, inevitably they are outsiders or newcomers, begin to reveal a character and personality traits that are deeply disturbing and very harmful. I tell people outside of the church who ask me about the bad people they see in the church that shock them, that if they took the time to read the Bible, they would not be so shocked that such people existed in the church. If they took seriously the warnings of Jesus that he made about people that would rise in the church, in terms of sayings, in terms of concepts like wolf and sheep's clothing. And those who he said would call him Lord, Lord, would actually be lawless and insubordinate. They would not be shocked. The apostles warn of similar kinds of people that rise in churches. I know of a minister and his wife who were driven prematurely into retirement and ill health because of one such destructive individual. I could go on with numerous examples of behaviour of individuals that might shock your conscience. But Paul is telling Titus in unmistakable terms, this is exactly what he's going to deal with in the ministry. As we would say, Paul determined that Titus would go into Crete with his eyes wide open. So don't you be surprised if you discover a person in the midst of a congregation that you serve that is a wild beast and eventually reveals some of these attributes. Beware of their behavior and opinions. Jesus described the kingdom of God like a great tree, onto the branches of which many birds have come to rest, and they are not all doves and sparrows. Secondly, following on from this, conflict should never shock us. A second lesson for Titus here, which we should also take note of as leaders, and yes, as sheep and ordinary members, is do not be surprised at conflict in the church. Generally, wild beasts start to damage a worker or at least threaten it. And the result is that the elders will move quickly and quietly to head the situation off. If they're doing their job, they confront the person graciously, but firmly, set the bounds of behavior along with the consequences of failing to comply and watch. Such men bear a lot of stress. They contain the trauma and the conflict within their private dealings with the person in the courts or the elders. However, sometimes such people will ignore this and will continue to stir trouble amongst the ordinary members, and so from time to time you may well see, as you may well have seen, conflicts which are public, unpleasant and disturbing. But remember this, this is the normal part of the life of a faithful church, and sometimes the great enemy of the church brings such people into the work to harm it. In fact, in some ways, it is a good sign that the church has been faithful. Satan does not bother with churches that are unfaithful. He doesn't need to. Lastly, I'm going to talk briefly about the concept of enculturation, for better or for worse. The final application has to do with this thing called enculturation. What we have here is a sober warning to the church about the process of enculturation. And enculturation is when one culture, by virtue of another of contact with another culture, adopts its beliefs and practices for better or for worse. In this case, Crete's behavior and its ethics were being copied into the Cretan congregations and becoming part of its DNA, so to speak. We have a Trojan horse principle here, or a virus principle, if you like. When the gifts that are given, and I'll put the gifts in inverted commas, contain ethical pollution like this, then the elders have to err on the side of keeping the world's culture right out of the life and ministry and worship in such a situation. The culture of Crete was famously ugly, as we've heard, even to the word, to the Cretans, being a byword. However, ultimately the cultures in which we live can have the same effect, and they in turn must be assessed, ruled, and reformed by Scripture. An African Christian once said to a British missionary who demanded a certain type of behaviour from him, "Is that because it's biblical? Or because it's British?" Just because Cretans are liars doesn't mean Christians can be too. We must change the culture when it's unbiblical, not the other way around. If we don't, we're not being faithful, and we may not even be regenerate. Titus was to aim at Cretan becoming Christian, and not the Christians becoming Cretans. Do you see then the relationship between the Christian faith and the culture is either transforming or being transformed? So who is adopting whose culture? That is the question. I think D.L. Moody once said famously that the relationship between the church and the world is like that between the ship and the water. It is perfectly natural and proper for the ship to be in the water. The real problem is when the water gets into the ship. When the culture, that is the unbiblical parts and features of it, gets into the church, she begins to start to sink spiritually and morally. In conclusion, the gospel is a transforming message. If Christ has died for your sins, then you too should be dying to them. You have eyes to see and ears to hear what is in your culture and how to compare it to what is in Scripture. Your new culture is Christ. It is Christ's life. It is Christ's teaching. The earthly culture, if there is one, which should be the fertile ground in which that Christ-like culture is nurtured and nourished, should be the fellowship of a sanctifying people. They are those who have left the ideas and the evils of the Cretes, their Cretes behind them, and they now act as agents of change into that old and dying culture. So there is no place for wild beasts, gluttons and lazy bones in the kingdom of God. Manifest Jesus Christ in your new life. Change your culture, or else you will be destroyed by it, even if you should remain in the invisible church. Amen. Let's all pray. Our God and our Father, as we live in the midst of our world, we are acutely aware that we have a culture which is anything but healthy. helpful to us more often than not. It is creeping in many ways. And so send us from this place with our eyes wide open. We would be enabled by the Spirit to enculturate our creep and not be enculturated by it. But we would look at our lives every day, the things that we do, and ask ourselves the question, what kind of culture is that that I am involved in? Grant, especially that our young people, you have less eyes to see than those of us who've lived through two, three generations, to be able to recognise what's corrupt. Help them to become students of Scripture, to put on the spectacles of the Word of God, so that they can measure all things by that. Unlike us, who can measure it by the culture that was once Christian and faithful in so many ways. Help us, we pray, all these things to the praise of your glory and for the good of our culture and nation. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing to conclude 453, Fight the Good Fight.